Welcome to St. Joseph Cathedral in Baton Rouge, Louisiana, for the celebration of the Holy Sacrifice of the Mass. We invite you to join in prayer with your Catholic neighbors and friends as we celebrate the Sunday Eucharist.
To Jesus Christ, our sovereign King, who is the world's salvation, all praise and homage do we bring, and thanks and adoration. Christ Jesus Victor, Christ Jesus Ruler, Christ Jesus Lord and
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. May the grace and peace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the King, be with you always. Amen. Welcome to St. Joseph Cathedral. It's wonderful to have you here on this solemn end of the Church's liturgical year, the solemnity of Christ the King. In a special way, I want to welcome not just our wonderful usual musicians, but also Dr. Ryan Hebert, who is up in the gallery organ, Providence. He played the prelude and will be assisting Robbie Jouard, our own organist and director of music, throughout the liturgy, helping to make this a more solemn and wonderful occasion of prayer. You may be wondering, where is the bishop this morning? Well, on the Feast of Christ the King, he's at the parish of Christ the King on the LSU campus, administering the sacrament of confirmation. But, of course, I know we're in his prayers wherever he is, and he is in ours. Let us begin our worship this day by calling to mind the fact that we are subjects of Christ the King. And if we are to do his will, that means being people less of sin and more of virtue. Lord Jesus Christ, King of the universe, you rule over us with wisdom and justice. Lord, have mercy. Lord Jesus Christ, King of the universe, on the throne of your cross, you gave your very life for the salvation of the world. Christ, have mercy. Lord Jesus Christ, King of the universe, you remain sovereign and judge over us. Lord, have mercy. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to life everlasting. Amen.
Gloria is found on the inside back cover of the hymnal.
Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to people of goodwill. We praise you, we bless you, we adore you, we glorify you. Thanks for your great glory.
Let us pray. Almighty ever-living God, whose will is to restore all things in your beloved Son, the King of the universe, grant, we pray, that the whole creation, set free from slavery, may render your majesty service and ceaselessly proclaim your praise. Through the same Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever. Amen. Let us listen now to God's holy word.
The first reading is a reading from the book of the prophet Ezekiel. Thus says the Lord God, I myself will look after and tend my sheep. As a shepherd tends his flock when he finds himself among his scattered sheep, so will I tend my sheep. I will rescue them from every place where they were scattered when it was cloudy and dark. I myself will pasture my sheep. I myself will give them rest, says the Lord God. The lost I will seek out. The strayed I will bring back. The injured I will bind up. The sick I will heal. But the sleek and the strong I will destroy, shepherding them rightly. As for you, my sheep, says the Lord God. I will judge between one sheep and another, between rams and goats. The word of the Lord.
A reading from the first letter of St. Paul to the Corinthians. Brothers and sisters, Christ has been raised from the dead, the first fruits of those who have fallen asleep. For since death came through man, the resurrection of the dead came also through man. For just as in Adam, all die, so too in Christ shall all be brought to life. But each one in proper order. Christ, the first fruits, then at his coming, those who belong to Christ. Then comes the end, when he hands over the kingdom to his God and Father, when he has destroyed every sovereignty and every authority and power. For he must reign until he has put all his enemies under his feet. The last enemy to be destroyed is death. When everything is subjected to him, then the Son himself will also be subjected to the one who subjected everything to him, so that God may be all in all. The word of the Lord.
Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the kingdom of our father David that is to come.
Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Matthew. Jesus said to his disciples, "When the Son of Man comes in his glory, and all the angels with him, he will sit upon his glorious throne, and all the nations will be assembled before him. And he will separate them, one from another, as a shepherd separates the sheep from the goats. He will place the sheep on his right and the goats on his left. Then the king will say to those on his right, 'Come, you who are blessed by my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. For I was hungry, and you gave me food. I was thirsty, and you gave me drink. A stranger, and you welcomed me. Naked, and you clothed me. Ill, and you cared for me. In prison, and you visited me.' Then the righteous will answer him and say, 'Lord, when did we see you hungry and feed you, or thirsty and give you drink? When did we see you a stranger and welcome you, or naked and clothe you? When did we see you ill or in prison and visit you?' And the king will say to them in reply, 'Amen, I say to you, whatever you did for one of the least brothers of mine,
you did for me. Then he will say to those on his left, depart from me, you accursed, into the eternal fire prepared for the devil and his angels. For I was hungry, and you gave me no food. I was thirsty, and you gave me no drink. A stranger, and you gave me no welcome. Naked, and you gave me no clothing. Ill and in prison, and you did not care for me. Then they will answer and say, Lord, when did we see you hungry or thirsty or a stranger or naked or ill or in prison and not minister to your needs? He will answer them, amen, I say to you, what you did not do for one of these least ones, you did not do for me. And these will go off to eternal punishment, and the righteous to eternal life. The Gospel of the Lord.
On the Feast of Christ the King, there are many images or symbols we could use to help focus our attention. The crown, of course, upon the king's head, the scepter he wields in his hand, the orb representing the extent of his rule that he carries, the richness of the royal robes, the splendor of the nobility surrounding him. So many images would capture our attention when you consider royalty of any sort, and especially the most excellent sovereign king, Christ Jesus himself. But it's to none of those more obvious symbols or images I'd like to draw your attention today. Something else, though, that is pretty much standard operating procedure for kings and queens throughout history and across time and space. You see it go on even now with the Queen of England, the King of Saudi Arabia, even the kings of unpronounceable name there on Game of Thrones. One of the things all monarchs do is hold court. They parade into their throne room, sit themselves on it, and there bid the nobles and the peasantry to come into their presence. What goes on there varies from time to time. Sometimes it is the subjects of the king coming into his presence to beg some favor, to ask some redress of grievances. At other times, the only one who does any talking is the king himself as he issues proclamations and commands. But it is in that court setting, gathered around the throne, that communication between monarch and subject, between citizen and ruler, takes place. It's a time of communication and, in just kingdoms, of dialogue. The reason I'd like to bring that image of kingship to you today is because here in our cathedral parish, on this last Sunday of the church's liturgical year, we've decided this year to focus on our stewardship of prayer. We deal with stewardship of finance and stewardship of ministry at other times, but the key to any activity in the church, even to any generosity, has to always be the spiritual foundation for that action, for that giving. We need to be a people of prayer as well. What is prayer? It has most often been described as communication with God. Communication that takes place in God's presence, of course. communication richly symbolized by that image of the king surrounded by the citizenry and nobility in his presence. Now, frankly, most of the prayer that we engage in is very active prayer. We're very good at offering praise and thanksgiving. We're even better at making petition for our needs. And when caught, we're good at repenting of our sin. But remember, not every court session in the throne room of the Lord is supposed to be where we come in and do all the talking. It is also time for us to come into the Lord's presence and hear his words. Sometimes these are words of command and challenge. We certainly had that in that famous gospel today from Matthew 25, where Christ says people will go to hell, and he says, and some will go to heaven. And he lays forth a very, very clear program of action on which is which. Sometimes the king issues words that are not quite so commanding and challenging, but more gentle. We heard words like that in that first reading from Ezekiel's prophecy, where the king is likened to a shepherd of the sheep. We, the flock of the Lord, are pastured by him, led by him, cared for by him, so that no harm comes to us from wolves or thieves. Sometimes, of course, even those gentle words are too loud. For when we come into the presence of the King, when we come into the presence of God himself, more than anything else, he speaks words of love to us. The words of challenge are words of love because he wants us to enter into the kingdom of his heavenly Father. He wants us to enjoy eternal life. The words of shepherding are words of comfort too, as we are led to green pastures and refreshing waters. But sometimes his words of love are barely perceptible. And that's where I simply want to issue the general warning, if the shoe fits, wear it. Do we sometimes spend too much time saying prayers? Entering into our own human activity, trying to somehow win a hearing before God, to where we don't even notice his voice. When someone is trying to reassure the beloved, "I love you," it almost always is said in the barest of whispers, in the gentleness of a voice that is a hush. As a matter of fact, when so-called lovers start telling each other at the top of their lungs things, it's usually a bad sign. God wishes to say, "I love you." And I guess the image I'd like to leave most with you about your prayer this year, this coming liturgical year, starting in Advent and Christmas and on throughout the year, is be people of prayer, make time for it, say the prayers you need to say and so forth. Have a full and rich attitude toward God, but make sure you build into that enough quiet time to hear him reassure you, to hear the Lord say, "I love you." It will be barely above a whisper so often that he does. Humanly speaking, we cannot live without love. We can't live without being reassured and cared for. It is very much in our best interest to hear the voice of God from his throne, but also from his heart, extend his mercy, compassion, and affection to us. We're not taking up a collection of stewardship of prayer forms. In the bulletin, you have lists and forms that might help you decide how to orient your spiritual life this year. Keep them as a reminder to yourselves. But be a people of prayer. Starting out in Advent is a wonderful time to begin. And in so doing, recognize you come into God's presence. Much communication and dialogue will take place. And if you pay close attention, you will hear God say, "I love you." God bless. Of course, prayer comes from a faith-filled heart. Could we stand now? The words of the Nicene Creed are on the inside front cover of the hymnal. Let us profess our faith together. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages. God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father, through him all things were made. For us men and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary and became man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. In celebration of Christ our King, let us now acknowledge the majesty of his care for us by offering our prayers in faith.
We pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
For all of us as loyal subjects of Jesus Christ the King, that we may faithfully follow him in whatever ways he leads us.
We pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy.
For Catholics throughout the world, that entry into the Advent season next weekend be an opportunity to strive for a deeper fidelity to God and his ways.
We pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy.
For our own life of prayer, that our listening to the Lord help guide us all of the other moments of our days.
We pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy.
For earthly leaders, that they may conduct the affairs of their countries with a grace and integrity that reflects the values of Christ our King.
We pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy.
For the success of our parish's Giving Tree project, that our parishioners will be generous to those in our community who lack much of what we take for granted.
We pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy.
For all who will receive the sacrament of baptism this weekend, especially Eleanor Catherine Holloman here at the cathedral, that their actions and words will direct others toward the love of Christ as they grow in faith.
We pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy.
For the homeless of our community, as the temperatures drop and winter arrives, that they find not only shelter from the cold, but the charity of others to warm their hearts.
We pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy.
For all who have died, including all those inscribed in our parish's Book of Remembrance, that the glory of the King of Kings be theirs forever.
We pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy.
Almighty Father, you have made us true citizens of your Son's eternal kingdom. Accept our professions of loyalty and faith, and receive these, our prayers, that our unity extend beyond time and space, unto mind and heart. We ask this in his name, Jesus Christ, our King and our Lord. Amen. Amen.
Thank you.
that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. May the Lord accept this sacrifice at our hands, for the praise and the glory of his name, for our good and the good of all his holy church. As we offer you, O Lord, the sacrifice by which the human race is reconciled to you, we humbly pray that your Son himself may bestow on all nations the gifts of unity and peace. Through the same Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God. For you anointed your only begotten Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, with the oil of gladness as eternal priest and King of all creation, so that by offering himself on the altar of the cross as a spotless sacrifice to bring us peace, he might accomplish the mysteries of human redemption. And making all created things subject to his rule, he might present to the immensity of your majesty an eternal and universal kingdom, a kingdom of truth and life, a kingdom of holiness and grace, a kingdom of justice, love, and peace. And so with angels and archangels, with thrones and dominions, and with all the hosts and powers of heaven, we sing the hymn of your glory, as without end we acclaim.
Holy, 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 Lord God of hosts, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest, Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna in the highest.
You are indeed holy, O Lord. And all creation rightly gives you praise. For through your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, by the power and working of the Holy Spirit, you give life to all things and make them holy. And you never cease to gather a people to yourself, so that from the rising of the sun to its setting, a pure sacrifice may be offered to your name. Therefore, O Lord, we humbly implore you, by the same Spirit, graciously make holy these gifts we have brought to you for consecration, that they may become the body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command we celebrate these mysteries. For on the night he was betrayed, he himself took bread, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it. For this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith.
When we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim your death, O Lord, until
Therefore, O Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the saving passion of your Son, his wondrous resurrection and ascension into heaven, and as we look forward to his second coming, we offer you in thanksgiving this holy and living sacrifice. Look, we pray, upon the oblation of your church, and recognizing the sacrificial victim by whose death you will to reconcile us to yourself, grant that we who are nourished by the body and blood of your Son and filled with his Holy Spirit may become one body, one spirit in Christ. May he make of us an eternal offering to you, so that we may obtain an inheritance with your elect, especially with the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with blessed Joseph, her spouse, with your blessed apostles and glorious martyrs, and with all the saints, on whose constant intercession in your presence we rely for unfailing help. May this sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and the salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth, with your servant Francis, our Pope, and Robert, our Bishop, the order of bishops, all the clergy, and the entire people you have gained for your own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family, whom you have summoned before you. In your compassion, O merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world. To our departed brothers and sisters, and to all who were pleasing to you at their passing from this life, give kind admittance to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestow on the world all that is good. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. At the Savior's command and formed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you. Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever. Amen. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
And let us help that peace to grow by sharing some small sign of it.
Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world.
Behold, the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed.
Our hymn of thanksgiving is found in Red Worship Hymnal at number 566. All hail the power of Jesus' name. Number 566. Please rise.
Let us pray. Having received the food of immortality, we ask, O Lord, that glorying in obedience to the commands of Christ, the King of the universe, we may live with him eternally in his heavenly kingdom, who lives and reigns forever and ever. Amen. Before we go, let me offer a word of thanks to you for coming. Thanks to the choir for singing. Thanks to Robbie and to Dr. Hebert for providing such wonderful music on this Feast of Christ the King. If you brought gifts for needy children or wish to make a donation to our Advent Giving Tree, it's in the rear of the cathedral. You'll get to put an ornament on the tree also if you bring a gift or make a donation, but it's not the ornament that's important, it's the generosity. If you're able to come back this evening at 6 p.m. here in the cathedral, all of the downtown churches, First Methodist, First Presbyterian, Mount Zion First Baptist, First Baptist, St. James Episcopal, and the Cathedral, we join together in a common ecumenical Thanksgiving service. We're hosting it once every 8 years we do. Please, everyone's invited back for a brief but very, very powerful service of thanks to the God who gifts us all. And finally, I do want to invite everyone to come on Wednesday, the night before Thanksgiving, to our vigil mass at 5 p.m. Bring the bread you're going to serve at your Thanksgiving feast. Bring a bottle of wine that you plan to imbibe. We'll bless it specially at that mass, in addition to asking God's grace upon the rest of our lives. Last of all, of course, we have open house in the new, expanded, enlarged, renovated hall. and we have extra food for you after this Mass. Please join us over there when you get a chance, okay? Number 571 in the hymnal is our final song. Number 571, we'll be doing verses 1 and 5. Verses 1 and 5 of number 571 on the way out. May the Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
And may the blessings of Almighty God now and always come upon you, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Our Mass is ended. Let us go forth, loyal subjects of Christ, our King. Thanks be to God.
Thank you for sharing in our presentation of the Sunday Mass. The community of St. Joseph Cathedral invites you to share in its faith and activities by receiving its weekly bulletin. Take a more active part in celebrating the loving presence of Christ with strength, compassion, and caring for all of God's people.